into the concert hall at the School of Music in the College of the Arts at USF. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the performance.
I thought there was no way out. I used to be scared of the light. And I was swallowed by doubt. I'd forgotten what freedom was like. Puzzle pieces on the floor, they don't fit in anymore. I'm changing, I'm changing. When they ask me who I am, what I've done and where I've been, there's one thing I want you to say. Tell them I'm brave, see it on my face. I am bigger than anything coming my way. It's a new day, yeah, we're not afraid. So if anyone asks you how you overcame, you can tell them I'm brave. Don't stop. I won't wish my troubles away. I've been down and I've been out, but if you look at me now, I'm blooming. I'm moving into better, brighter days. Yeah, this hope is here to stay. There's one thing that you can say.
Everyone, my name is Erin Gallagher, and I am the interim executive director of This Is My Brave. I'm so glad you're here, and we're glad to be here. This show is our official return to the stage. We are so thrilled. We have been waiting for this moment for 2 years, and we couldn't be more grateful to spend this evening with all of you. With me tonight is This Is My Brave's director of programming, Katie Grant. Natasha West. We're all wearing these teal scarves and name badges, so please stop and say hello if you see us outside after the show. This Is My Brave was created in 2014 by Jennifer Marshall and Anne-Marie Ames. For 7 years, Jennifer Marshall led this organization fearlessly, taking us from one show in Arlington, Virginia, with 11 storytellers, to 80 shows, with an alumni community of nearly 1,000 storytellers. Jen stepped down at the end of 2021, so we are here to continue her work combining storytelling and the performing arts to break down stigma surrounding mental illness and addiction. I met Jennifer in 2017 after losing my son, Jay, to suicide. I was impressed with Brave's mission to end the stigma associated with mental illness, something I know contributed significantly to my son's suffering. Jay didn't know that it was okay not to be okay. He didn't know that 1 in 5 Americans live with a mental health condition. He didn't know that help was available or that recovery is possible. Jay didn't know that he could find community and hope in a place like a theater doing a show like This Is My Brave. This is why I am so proud to be a part of this organization where we shine a light on the stories of people who are living well and thriving while managing a mental health condition so that others can know that they are not alone. There is hope. Help is available. We're here at USF because opening up conversations surrounding mental health is imperative for our college students. It is reported that up to 44% of college students have disclosed experiencing symptoms of anxiety and depression. Of those who have been diagnosed with a mental health disorder, 75% had their first episode by the age of 24. Even more alarming, suicide is now the third leading cause of death for college students. The time to talk about this is now, and we must start these conversations and then keep them going. We at Brave became acquainted with USF several years ago when we partnered with Dr. Kristen Kosilek and her team of researchers at the Star Lab to do research on our work at Brave. Dr. Kosilek has talked ever since then for years about producing one of our shows, and so finally we are here. Not only are they professionally and personally invested in This Is My Brave, they just couldn't pass up the chance to share with their entire campus and community what they already know as a result of their research, that storytelling saves lives. Thank you to all of you who have assisted in the research and in preparation for this show. This is a dream come true for all of us. Before I introduce everyone, I want to take a moment to thank our national sponsors, whose support makes our work at Brave possible. Many thanks to AbbVie, Alkermes, Janssen Neuroscience, Society of Valued Minds, brought to you by Otsuka Pharmaceuticals, and Sage Therapeutics. The Brave students you're about to meet have come together to bring their stories of resilience and hope to the stage because they know that their stories have the power to encourage their peers not to give up. By opening up conversations about mental health through storytelling, we are breaking down unfair societal pressures that tell us that perfection is key. But we know that it's okay not to be okay. By sharing our stories, we normalize the fact that sometimes our brains get sick, just like our bodies, and our mental health is just as valid as our physical health. We believe that when one person shares their story, it gives others permission to do the same. We have a saying at This Is My Brave, and it is brave multiplies brave. Our Brave USF cast tonight is about to join a community of storytellers from all over the country who've decided to be brave and share their truths on this stage. You're about to experience something magical. This Is My Brave's vision is that one day we will live in a world where we won't have to call it brave to talk openly about mental illness and addiction. We will simply call it talking. So let's get started. Please join me in welcoming to the stage Dean Chris Garvin of the College of the Arts.
Well, thank you for that. That was a very inspiring opening speech, and I certainly can't top it. Thank you so much for being here at the School of Music. We are so happy to be a part of this and to help support this. It's a very important, important thing for us in colleges. And I wanted to thank Fannie Green, one of our professors here, for helping some of the students not be perfect, but refine themselves a little bit better, which is what we do with students. And it's very hard when you're dealing with students in the arts because the myth of perfection weighs heavy on them. And we are entrusted with 1,500 students in this college. And we worry that if we don't support them in every way, physically, mentally, and on their dreams to become performers, that we fail them in some way. So being a part of this helps us do our mission, and we thank you all for this. And I thank these students for doing this. And I want to personally thank them because they're helping me be brave, because I suffer from mental illness like a lot of people here do. And it's hard some days. And some days it's easier, and it's always hard to admit that in public. And I hope for a day where talking about it is not brave, but talking about it is just talking. So thank you again. I hope you enjoy this show, and thank you for what you've done for me.
Now I'd like to welcome a representative of one of our sponsors, Katie Kinney, from the Society of Valued Minds.
Hi everyone, I'm Katie. I've met a few of you guys outside already. I'm part of the Society of Valued Minds team. I'm so thankful to be here and so honored to be collaborating with an organization like This Is My Brave. The strength that you guys all have is incredibly inspiring, and the bravery, it just blows my mind, and I really wish this was around when I was in college. So our mission at Society of Valued Minds is to show every single person that their mind is valuable the way that it is, exactly that way. We were founded by a healthcare company, Otsuka Pharmaceuticals, just about a year ago, and the sole purpose of our platform is to build awareness and fight mental health stigma through creative self-expression. Whether that be dancing, yoga, I love doing crafts, some people love graphics, et cetera. Self-expression truly has a positive effect on your mental health. So it's really simple to join us in this mission. Right now we're only on Instagram, so if you can take out your phones, follow us on Society of Valued Minds on Instagram. We would love that. Then you're in and you're officially welcome to the society. And then we would love to feature any of your stories, your creative self-expression, anything else along the way. So you could just shoot us a DM. It's usually me or one of my counterparts answering. So we're really passionate about it all. We just want to make an impact. We want to work with all of you guys directly. And we want you to know that your mind is valuable in every way. So we'll be here all night. Please come say hello to us after the show. Love to talk to you guys and enjoy. Thank you.
Dr. Kathleen Moore, who is the Executive Director of the Florida Mental Health Institute. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Moore.
Good evening, everyone. As Erin said, my name is Kathleen Moore, and I'm the Executive Director of the Florida Mental Health Institute, as well as Research Professor in the College of Behavioral and Community Sciences. As FMHI director, I am honored, we are honored, to co-sponsor This Is My Brave, the college edition. The mission of FMHI is to improve the lives of people with mental health, addiction, and developmental disorders through research, policy, training, and education. This aligns so well with the goals of This Is My Brave, which is trying to change the stigma of mental illness by bringing inspiring stories and performers to share and uplift our community. As you will soon see, we have wonderful performers who have the courage to share their story through dance, comedy, poetry, and other art forms. To be able to get up on this stage and open your heart to us shows incredible resilience and strength of character. These collective stories show us that with courage, you can overcome anything. When I was in my late teens and early 20s, I also struggled with self-confidence, anxiety, trying to fit in with my peers. Finding my path took time, and when I found my passion for working in the field of behavioral health and wanting to help other people, things just started to click into place for me. Today, I am so lucky to be working in a college with faculty and staff who share these same ideals. One of our colleagues is our own Dr. Kristen Kasilik, and she has been working with This Is My Brave for several years now in order to increase the impact and reduce the stigma of mental illness, as well as addiction. With this connection, she was able to bring the college edition of This Is My Brave to USF. Kristen, along with her team, as has been mentioned, has been working tirelessly. We started this work way back in the fall to bring us a wonderful performance this evening. Without further ado, I am proud to introduce my friend, my colleague, and more importantly, a wonderful human being, Dr. Kristen Kasilik.
Welcome to This Is My Brave College Edition, a OneUSF production. My name is Dr. Kristen Kasilik, and to begin, I'd like to thank all of you for coming tonight to witness the University of South Florida shine a light on the stories of brave individuals who are living well and thriving despite a diagnosed mental health condition. Before we begin, I'd like to take a moment to thank our supporters. The content of tonight's production was developed under the Arts Learning Grant, Race, Equity, Arts, and Cultural History, or REACH, from the Department of Education. Thank you to the Lewis De La Parte Florida Mental Health Institute for its generous support of the production. Thank you also to the College of the Arts and Dean Garvin, and to the College of Behavioral and Community Sciences and Dean Sarovich for providing us with space and resources to make this event possible. We'd also like to give a special thank you to our photographer, Laura Lyon, staff photographer at USF's Office of Innovative Education, and our videographers, Frank Ranieri and Sharon McCammon of Communicasting, Inc. You are allowing us to capture something very important tonight that we can look back on for years to come. Thank you for your support. To the incredible USF production team, this show would not have been possible without your generous and passionate commitment of your time and talents. Thank you, Dr. Denise Davis Cotton, Cameron or Cam Talley, Dr. Angela Hill, Michelle Wilkes, Patty Harrison, Molly Ernick, Jennifer Tran, Kristen Kuzianic, Holly Barron, Melissa Carlson, Dr. Kathy Moore, I've lost my place, Amariah Navoa, and Jacqueline or Jackie Costco. An extra special thank you to Amanda Clark, co-producer and stage manager of this show. She's behind the stage tonight running the show, but her contributions and dedication to this production put her center stage. Thank you, Amanda. Before we get started, a few housekeeping items. If everyone could please take out your cell phone, I know that the recording earlier told you not to do this, but it's okay. This Is My Brave is a very social organization, and we want you to take lots of pictures, selfies, video clips, and share these on your social networks by tagging at This Is My Brave and using the hashtag Storytelling Saves Lives. What you are about to experience defines what it means to live brave. And we need your help to tell the world that we're here so they can learn what it means to live brave too. So share away, don't be shy. Our social media team will do their best to retweet and regram as many posts as possible to help extend our reach. Though we encourage you to keep those cell phones out, now would be a good time to make sure you turn your phone to silent. Since This Is My Brave is a storytelling organization, I thought it would make sense for me to tell you the story of how I learned about This Is My Brave and my reason for getting involved. In 2015, the co-founder and former executive director of This Is My Brave, Jennifer Marshall, connected with me, looking for someone to establish This Is My Brave as an evidence-based stigma reduction program. It has been my privilege to partner with This Is My Brave for the past 7 years as their lead program evaluator. Our research shows that This Is My Brave is effective for reducing stigma and improving attitudes towards treatment seeking among the audience members. and that we have also documented the impact of being a part of our Brave cast, showing that cast members experience an increased sense of empowerment, self-esteem, self-efficacy, and optimism as a result of their Brave journey. Therefore, it is with great confidence in the benefits of this program that I have had the joy of working with our production team and amazing cast members over the course of the past 7 months to bring this production here to USF. Really is a dream come true. We're about to take you on a journey. You will laugh and you may cry. You will be enlightened and inspired. And our hope is that you will leave with a transformed impression of what the face of mental illness looks like, thanks to the bravery of our cast. Mental illness can happen to anyone. A person with a mental illness doesn't have a distinct look. They look like you and me and the cast members you will meet on this stage. The reality of mental illness is this. 1 in 5 to 1 in 4 Americans lives with a diagnosable mental health condition. Research suggests that 39% of students in college experience significant mental health issue, yet 67% of people between the ages of 18 and 24 who live with anxiety or depression do not seek treatment. This is one of the reasons why the number 2 leading cause of death among young adults is suicide. We are uncomfortable talking about mental illness and addiction, so many believe they are alone in their experiences and suffer in silence. This changes today, right here on the stage. We're shining a light on mental illness to show the world that we are students, we are faculty, and professionals. We are your friends, your peers, your colleagues, your neighbors, your family. We hope that through our storytelling, you will better understand mental illness and addiction, and you will be able to be supportive of those in your life who may experience it. Who knows? You may even be inspired to share your own story one day. It's when we share our stories that we open up the conversation and break down stigma. Tonight, we are letting the USF campus know that storytelling saves lives. We also want to note that some of the stories may be distressing for some audience members. If you need a break at any point, we understand. Your experiences are valid. If needed, please quietly exit the theater and see one of the ushers who will be able to connect you with one of the mental health professionals we have here, part of our production team, and provide you with a variety of mental health resources. Thank you again to everyone for being here. And to everyone who put so much into this show. Let's get started. It is my honor to welcome our first performers to the stage for their group dance piece titled Hindsight.
Hi, everyone. The piece we're about to perform can mean many different things for many people, but for me personally, I'm about to express my eating disorder and my situational depression from tearing my ACL last spring. And as a dancer, this was a really hard situation to go through, but one of the biggest things I noticed in my journey was how much support and love I received from all my loved ones, peers, my family, teachers, and they really helped me through my recovery, not only through my knee, but also with my mental health. And I just want everyone to know through this performance that it's okay to ask for help, and it's okay to lean on others when they offer support.
Hi, everyone. My name is Samantha Kedziora. We were lucky enough to put this piece together for This Is My Brave. We're each dance majors, and we've each struggled with our own mental health issues. But one we kind of felt the most tied to, I guess, was depression. So this piece is loosely based on depression, the way that it can affect one person and those around them, a society of people, those who are more predisposed and those who aren't. But also, this piece is definitely open for your own interpretation. So thank you.
My name is Emilee Carreras, and this is my brave.
My name is Samantha Kedziora, and this is my brave.
My name is Sabina Reilly, and this is my brave.
My name is Francesca Petraglia, and this is my brave.
My name is Katie Brophy-Chronister, and this is my brave.
Thank you.
if I'm out of breath. But just a little bit of insight into this piece. As a dance major, I'm graduating this semester. We are required to create a senior BFA solo. I really struggled trying to figure out what kind of concept I wanted for my solo, and at the time that I was supposed to have my concept and choreography started, I couldn't think of anything, and I was also just starting recovery for an eating disorder I had had for about 3 years. So that was kind of a constant on my mind. And then it was a little bit of a bold choice to make my senior exiting solo about an eating disorder, especially when you've heard already so far that mental health isn't such a thing that's just talked about. It's something that you need to be brave to talk about. So I kind of, at that point, decided that I would advocate more than I ever had for mental illness and advocating for it. And I really wanted this piece to obviously be about my own mental health struggles, but also open for interpretation for anyone else, just in the sense that we've most likely all had the feeling of being trapped and entangled in strings, and something in your mind is just not letting you get through, and the journey of starting kind of like realizing it and then being very stuck in it, and then the end when the string is still on my foot is just saying that although I'm kind of overcoming what I've experienced, I'm not ever gonna forget the journey that I was on, and it'll always be a part of me. But again, open for interpretation. Thank you guys so much. My name is Samantha Kedziora, and this is my Brave, and I would like to welcome up Christian.
Hello, my name is Christian Marquez. Outside of simply being human, I am a poet and aspiring actor. I do try my best to deal with the cards life has given me, but I have always been bad at card games. I am a domestic violence and sexual assault survivor, and I'm currently living with major depression, anxiety, and PTSD. I'm not necessarily one who's risen above odds. My story started one day, and I've not yet reached my happy nor somber ending. But I think I'll get there one day. I'm trying. And within all of these attempts at this crazy construct of life, my biggest goal above all is to pause time, even if just for a moment, and remind myself and others what it's like to be human when it's all we try to forget. This piece I've written for you today is called In Search of How to Be Me, and it's a piece of my journey in trying to get back to the person I used to be, wherever he's hiding. This is my story, and thank you for being a part of it. Hey, I wrote you a letter, but I lost it somewhere. In between here and the corner of our daydreams, I think. But I forget that you don't go there anymore. I'm trying to be better at staying on the ground, but there's nothing left of me except the idea that something is supposed to fill this space inside of me, so I'm weightless, lost. I do little things, like remembering that our favorite color was blue and that your safe place was airports, but we haven't felt that safe lately, have we? Empty terminals have never been this loud. I know that now I spend my time trapped inside my favorite sad songs, that now I make my brain wait its turn behind intrusive thoughts and cheers of I'm not good enough, that now depression stopped leaving their shoes at the door. They stopped watering the memories I've struggled so hard to keep beautiful, making messes of my peace, thinning the air, tying me down and clamping jumper cables to my chest to kickstart some other part of me that died alongside who I remember being. I miss you. I miss the way we gave our secrets to our bedroom walls and how we wore numbness so proudly on our sleeve. The way that lonely felt like home. I am so sorry that I lost you. I've just been trying to catch up because I know I'm running behind. And by running, I mean limping. And by limping, I mean there are pieces of our broken past living in the soles of my feet that remind me that chasing you is all I have left. I've decided to sew happy into my smile so the world is clueless of the mess inside. It's just been hard to be clean lately, but I promise I'll get this fixed up once I remember who he was. I mean, who I was. I mean, who we were. Who we are. Anyway, I'll be waiting for you between our empty airports and underneath pale blue skies, and if I don't find you there, I'll search for you in bathroom mirrors. Behind hazel eyes and repressed memories, but we haven't been there for a long time. Again, my name is Christian Marquez, and this is my brave. I'd like to introduce our next storyteller, Kailen.
So, as Christian said, my name is Kailen, and I will be reading two of my poems for you today. What? How could this be? You're too smart, too pretty, too well-behaved. Neurodivergent? Psychiatric disability? Not you. Couldn't be you. I've never seen you have a meltdown or stem. You don't need coursework accommodations. You're just being lazy. Why are you so upset? You're too soft, too sensitive, too naive. You just want to, you want to succeed, right? Then you just need to try a little harder. There's no need for a pity party. How is it that one person can be too much and not enough, all in the same moment? Just like an alien stranded in a foreign land, pity is the last thing I desire. I seek to understand the world around me, the place I was thrust into without my consent. I am Truman, and you are the cast, causing me to believe that the world is at my fingertips. And that I can do anything I set my mind to. When in reality, this perfectly curated world was never mine to begin with. The well-being of people like me was never in the mind's eye of our society. So I fight, I question, and I advocate. But my voice makes your ears bleed. My reality and my truth frighten you. Why? The eggshells that cause you to grimace when you are near me were never my doing. You threw that egg on the ground, putting the blame on me when it caused you to bleed. I am not here to make you more comfortable. I am me, and that is enough. The poem I am about to read to you is dedicated to the world that still does not yet understand, and the other aliens who have been stranded here, as I have. To the world too big for my hands to hold, and a body too small for my soul to fit. She could never quite place her finger on it, what it was about the whimsy of the world that made her stay. Its frigidness was unpredictable. It trickled through the hearts of man. The erosion created a unique mark on everyone it touched. There are some that scurry through this life, desperately trying to mold back together that which the world has eaten away. Like a broken piece of pottery that needs to be mended, always needing to be perfect or all functionality is lost. Control is what she craved, but never truly what she wanted. The chaos of this world was always too cruel for her heart to handle. She wanted to smother it, put out this hellfire that has consumed the world she is forced to call home. But her body is too small and the world too big for her to bear all on her shoulders. But if not me, then who? She thought. At night, she would wrestle with the demons in her mind, and to the lullabies of their unfulfilled promises baptized her into the sweet depths of unconsciousness. There, her sleep was dark and dreamless, for her days were filled with a world that was too loud and provided her with a form that was never quite right. She would tell me she felt as if she was meant to sprout wings ages ago and longed to disappear to a place neither here nor there, the realm between a dream and a wish, some place she couldn't quite reach. At night, I would hold her in my arms as her body heaved and quivered, crying out, "I feel as if I'm a soul trapped inside a body, lost in a world which it has never belonged. I've yearned for places that they say do not exist, and yet they call to me." When the moon had risen far into the night sky and her eyes had finally fluttered shut, I laid beside her, stroking the hair from her face. There, in that moment, I saw a smile dance across her lips, and I knew she made her landing. Thank you. So, growing up, I was never a competitive child. I craved peace and compassion. The chaos of competition put me on edge, knowing I would never be good enough, fast enough, or smart enough to win. Always worried that I would not live up to the standards I felt were placed upon me. Just wanting to be liked in a world that left me feeling so out of place. It's as if the cosmos never meant to breathe the chaos of my soul into this body. My mother calls it a miracle. I say it was a fluke. At least that is what the old Kailen would have said. There were times that I truly believed that I was put here as some twisted form of entertainment for a higher power, just waiting for the next shoe to drop so I can hear the laugh track of confirmation off in the distance. The denial I held was so powerful, even I was unaware of what I was doing. Eating disorders know no race, gender, or sexuality. She is hungry, and it will take whatever you have. It is estimated that 1 in 10 Americans will experience an eating disorder at some point in their lives. When left undiagnosed or untreated, eating disorders are considered the most fatal of all mental health conditions. Please, if you know someone or you yourself are struggling, reach out for help or come talk to me after the show. This is not a battle that we can fight alone, and you are worthy of having a battalion at your side. I dedicate this next poem to my mom, who was my compass and the wind in my sails during my darkest of storms. What she can never say, a letter from my mother. As I held her in my arms for the first time, I thanked God that I was blessed with a baby girl. But with girls comes trouble, you see. People would beckon to her, wanting to feel her soft curls beneath their fingertips, asking me if they could explore the ocean in her eyes, not knowing how hard it is to swim in unstable waters. How is someone supposed to know something is truly wrong when they are born sick to begin with? You were born sick to begin with. Watching someone you love die is like having your hands bound with an invisible rope. I thrash and cry, but words can only get me so far. Your veins have become so thin that hospital visits have turned your body into a battleground. I would cringe at the perversions of the needle slithering its way through your arms like an unwanted lover. If my eyes could speak, they would tell you that I have wept the ocean that yours used to hold, but you no longer see me. I would tell you that you're beautiful and that the girl in the mirror thrives off of lies, but you can no longer hear me. It is no secret that your mind has become polluted and your ears are muddled with the fabrication she has told you. The authenticity of your laughter is gone, and the shine of your hair has faded. I believe you lost them in the darkness of your room, fumbling to change your clothes before the room illuminates with light again. I see the words you so desperately wish to say. They claw at your throat, but you insist otherwise, leaving only your lies for nourishment. Instead, you have learned to pop pills to swallow the sadness. I do not know which is worse, watching my daughter turn into the shell of a girl she once was, or knowing that you are trapped in a hell I do not know how to resurrect you from. You have become lost, wandering through the valleys of your rib cage, searching for the substance that you have denied yourself. You will find it. One day, you will untie the ribbon made of barbed wire and self-loathing from around your waist. Air will once again fill your lungs, allowing you to taste new life. You will walk outside and no longer see that familiar world of gray, but instead, that the beauty of the world was always there. Most importantly, you will finally allow yourself to just be. My name is Kailen Bell, and this is my brave, and I would like to introduce Kellan.
Sorry about that. I was told I moved my feet around a little too much, so I've taken some preventative measures. Fun bit, I know. We'll just have to take it as that. So, as you all gaze upon me on the stage, it's pretty obvious to note that this guy can play basketball. Everyone doing good? It's been pretty sad right now, I know. Don't worry, it's gonna get worse. Anyway, so, I really don't mean to brag, but I was on the JV basketball team in high school. And if that surprises you, it definitely surprised me. You see, I don't have many things going on for me that a basketball player should have. I'm not very tall, I'm not very strong. If anything, I'm pretty quick, which is good for basketball, but not so good for relationships. But despite all these, how you say, shortcomings, I was genuinely surprised when I was told I was on the team. I felt like they had scraped the bottom of the barrel and I was the residue at the end of it, and I had just barely gotten on. I felt like I was the last pick, and when it came to picking out the jerseys, I actually was. So We got all of the JV kids in line, and this was the start, and this was the end, and this is where I was. And what ended up happening is all of the clothes that fit me got taken. So I ended up with a size extra large jersey and a size extra, extra large pair of shorts. Every time I suited up for a game, I felt like I was in a Weight Watchers commercial. And it became very apparent that this did not fit me during the first game. It was around the third quarter, and the coach tells me to get in the game. And so I excitedly stand up, and I go to retie the elastic waistband that is barely holding this on to me. And I guess in my excitement, I accidentally pulled too hard, and I ripped it. So I immediately knew that this is a problem, and I had to play basketball for about 30 to 45 seconds the entire time, afraid that at any moment, if I let my hand slip, I was going to accidentally moon the 12 people in the audience. And so I was told to go sit back down on the bench, where I stayed for the rest of the game and the rest of the season. But this just shows I was on the team. I played games on the team, which also meant I had to do summer conditioning. Now, the coach did something every 3 years, 2 or 3 years, and he would take all of the summer conditioning kids up to Ohio State, up to Ohio where he's from, and you'd be able to eat home-cooked meals with his mother, and we'd be able to go tour the University of Ohio State and play, like, basketball with college players. And that sounds really fun. But there was one little issue when it came to going on this trip. You see, there were only 13 spots on the bus, and there were 14 kids on the team. And so while I was the last pick, I didn't get that lucky this time. And so while all of my teammates got on that bus and they drove up, I was stuck at home. But I did get a complimentary free bag before them, so I think I was the one who really came out on top. But I felt isolated, I felt alone, I felt estranged. I didn't feel like I belonged, and I didn't feel like that the moment I got on the team, much less right then and there. And so I reluctantly stayed, and I tried to push through it, and my anxiety, my stress continued to build. I would want to slam my hand in a locker door just to get out of going to practice because I didn't want to mess up. I didn't want to be the reason why we had to do suicides or we had to run laps. I was afraid that I'd let my teammates down. And I was so terrified that the anxiety consumed me. I would punish myself. Little hits, hair pulling. I would try and punish my imperfections. And I somehow stayed on the team for almost the end of the season. Last week, I finally realized that I've had enough and I quit because I didn't want to hurt anyone else. I didn't want to make it so that I was the problem. And I realized at that moment that I don't have to wear tank tops where my arms were exposed, and I could start wearing long sleeves. And I began to cut myself. And I did that for quite some time. And there was this eye-opening experience that happened months later. I was in my room having another little mental breakdown, and my arm was the violin, the knife was the bow, and I played the fiddle like I was Cotton Eye Joe. And I did it so hard, so fast, and so deep that I could see actual, like, impressions in my arm, and I still have, people in the back can't see, but I still have marks on my body to this day. And that was the day I was like, oh, maybe this isn't a good thing. Maybe I should stop. But is it that easy? No. So what ended up happening is I continued to do it, although I had a break, because it wasn't just something I could turn on or turn off. It's how I was treating myself, punishing myself. I learned this behavior. Like, I started it, and I just couldn't stop. And now, I'm a year and a half clean. I haven't done it in that long. And part of the... Have I had moments where I've gotten very close? Yes. But One of the things, the most important thing to me is that I want to lead by example. I don't want to cut, because if I do, that's giving someone else an excuse to as well. I need to stay strong. And so, all of you in the audience, I can guarantee that either you have gone through this or you know someone who's gone through this, and they might not have told you. I didn't tell my mom for the longest time. And so, I just want to say for all of you that there are resources for this. I have called the suicide hotline number more times than I can count. I have gone to therapy. I should go back to therapy. And I've had friends who I've had conversations with, and I've tried to be open with this. And I hope that me being open with this can make it so that you or a family member or anyone in your life can be open and be brave as well. My name is Kellan Johnston, and this is my brave. Please continue. Feeds in there. That was a joke. No, you don't have to. You're not obliged. I'd like to introduce Aishwarya.
Aishwarya. Through the COVID-19 pandemic, physician burnout became more prevalent than ever. I saw news stories about incredible physicians taking their own lives. You'd think that they'd have gotten the preventative mental health care, but mental health is greatly stigmatized in healthcare. Around the same time, I was applying to medical school. I was wary about my decision because I was going through my own mental health battles. I wanted to make changes in healthcare, and that kept me going with my decision. Now that I'm a first-year medical student, it's evident to me that mental health is not prioritized or accounted for. Resources are offered, but there is only so much time in the day, and the accommodations are minimal. When things get really tough, you're just suggested a leave of absence. While that may be helpful, it puts you behind, and schools can take you out of their programs if the leave is longer than permissible by the school. I've seen classmates struggling to speak up about their challenges because we're expected to put on brave faces. We're all going through the same thing, so how can we complain about our depression and anxiety to each other? This kind of internal battle persists onwards. I've seen my first-year resident roommates struggling to take care of their basic needs because of the demands of residency. And no matter how horrible their physical and mental health is, they have to keep going or they could get kicked out. The threat of losing your career is always in the back of people's heads as they are trying to provide care but not getting any themselves. Ultimately, there isn't any trust that the system will support physicians through the challenges that they face with their mental health. And trust is something I've struggled with my whole life. I believe things can get better, but this poem I've written describes my relationship with trust. More specifically, the lack of it. Trust. I have very little of it. Sometimes, I can't even fight it in me. I pretend to show comfort in other people's trust. Is it fair to have so much doubt in others? Maybe it's justified because the years of abuse makes me afraid of their touch. The stolen tears and the stolen dimes makes me hold on ever so tightly onto my pockets and my eyes. The questions I ask haunt me every day. Will they leave me? Will they hurt me? Will they lie to me? Is it even worth it? As I grow wary and filled with doubts, my relationships drift away. I choose to be alone. At least I can trust myself. Or can I? My name is Aishwarya Vuppala, and this is my brave. I'd like to introduce Gabby.
So So my name is Gabby, and I'm what the doctors call mentally ill. So I used to have severe anxiety, but now it's just general anxiety disorder. So I really worked my way up the alphabet. I had not the slightest clue on how to heal myself and like stop being anxious, but I saw a therapist. I have amazing friends and family who support me. I watch too many movies, listen to too much music, and I just try new things every day. But back in the day, I did not know what to do. I was the definition of how not to be anxious, basically. For example, I hate driving. I got in 3 car accidents in the past year. Only one of them was my fault, okay? But I did not like driving. A normal person would, you know, they'd be like, okay, car accident, okay, let me just look forward, drive normal. I look forward and I look back and I look at my rearview mirror and that mirror and that mirror. I look at my feet to make sure if I'm stepping on the gas or the brake, am I gonna slam into the car in front of me? Who knows? I even tried to look it up online. I was like, is it safe for me to drive in a car? And it said, no, it's safer to be in an airplane, which I have way more anxiety about than to be in a car. I'm just gonna take Ubers wherever I go. Another thing I have anxiety about is just social interactions. I work at a school, I know, and I just see teachers coming and going, and usually they're like, oh, good morning. And I'm like, oh. So normal person would be like, oh, good morning, Cheryl. Nice to see you. Have a good day. But what I do is I'm, yes. Okay, I'm never getting a job at that school ever again, okay? But I just get so much anxiety from different things. Like, I'm literally such a picky eater. If my food touches, I will scream. But my room is a total mess. So is my brain. So I just really don't have time to be anxious, or maybe it's just my hobby. But that's just the branches in my tree of anxiety, okay? There's always roots when it comes to trees, and I have roots, okay? Back when I was a little freshman girl, I just moved schools, and I was begging my mom to go to a football game. I'm a theater kid. I don't know why I had any business going to a football game, but I was like, Mom, please, I need to go to this football game. Like, if I don't go, I'm just not going to make any friends, and if I don't make any friends, it's going to be my old school. In my old school, I got really sick and I threw up all the time, and that's why I had to transfer schools, and I don't want to eat alone in the bathroom anymore, so can I please, please go to this football game? My Hispanic mother, she looked at me, and she goes, yeah? Who's driving? Because it's not going to be me, okay? I told you once, I told you twice, Gabriela Maria Fotopoulos Cordova, Sabas Rion, Scaloo, why are you asking? And I was like, okay, Mom, okay, I don't want you to like start talking in Spanish to me. So a normal person would be like, okay, Mom, I understand, have a great day. But me, I throw myself on the bed like a Disney princess, and I cry in a well of tears. And my reaction was to write a suicide note. Thinking back to it, why would I ever commit suicide? I am so anxious of the unknown and all of that mess. So I don't know why. I was just, but yeah, so I promise that was funny. It wasn't at the time, not to my mom or my guidance counselor. But yeah, another thing that is like a root of my anxiety is dating in high school. Please never date in high school. I'm telling you right now, just don't. I don't recommend. Okay, 0 stars. Did you know that 1 in 3 high school relationships are abusive? And that I was the 1 in 3? I feel like those dentists, like 3 out of 4 recommend. And I was that one dentist that was like, no, I don't think you should go with that toothpaste. But yeah, my ex-boyfriend was horrible. He fat-shamed me, said I was worthless. And me, I just thought that's what a normal boyfriend did. So I was like, oh, thank you so much. But you know, a normal person would just break up with the guy, okay? Just cut your losses. But what I did is I stayed with him for 2 more years. Not the brightest idea, considering I'm in college. But anyway, another big thing that gives me anxiety now is trying to impress my mom. My mom is like my biggest role model, the person I look up to the most in my life. And all I want to do is make her proud of me. A normal person would be like listening to their mom's advice, getting good grades, you know, the normal stuff. But what I do is I disappoint my mother all the time. Literally, since I've been in elementary school, I used to dig a hole in my backyard and put my report card in it and bury it. And then I would go to my mom, look her dead in the eye, and lie to her that I did not get my report card that day. My little sister, she'd be like, well, I got my report card today, so I don't know what you're talking about. And I was like, shut up. And my mom would be like, okay, where's your report card? And I'm like, the dog buried it. Funny story, he eats my homework as well. But yeah, so I just, you know, don't get good grades. Disappointment. I'm the oldest child, so like, I'm the example, but I'm just a disappointment. And I just always just don't know how to make her happy and make her proud of me, you know, just like she does for me. She's literally got her master's in cybersecurity. Like, how am I supposed to compete with that? But all the time, she just wants to know about my life. Like, she's my biggest role model. Even, doesn't matter how many times I mess up, she's like, oh my gosh, how's college? Are you doing drugs yet? Did you get a tattoo? Oh my gosh, are you going to parties? Are you drinking? Like, what is going on? Are you having sex? And I'm like, whoa, how am I supposed to tell my mother I'm not doing any of those things? How am I supposed to tell my mother that I can't have sex because I was sexually abused? Please laugh. I'm so sorry. How am I supposed to tell my mother that I couldn't stop what was happening to me? How am I supposed to tell my mom that I just had to sit there and do nothing, and I couldn't say no for 2 years, and I just couldn't stop it, and I always thought it was my fault, and I still suffer now because some jerk did this to me and hurt me in the worst possible way. How can I tell my mother that? Well, I just did. Thank you. But on a serious note, it is not your fault. And it took me years of realizing that I was even abused. And it took me another couple years to realize that it wasn't my fault. You're valid. Your feelings are valid. And there's help and there's support. And one day you will find what love actually means, because that was what love was not. And now I know in my heart what it is to be surrounded by people who actually care and love you. And I'm just so thankful that I've been able to have therapists, and I've been able to have such amazing friends and family, and watch too many movies and listen to too much music, and now I'm here crying on a stage. But yeah, I have a lot of anxiety right now talking in front of you. I have my anxiety ring on. Okay, I'm not engaged. It's just, it twirls. But so I'm just gonna leave now. Thank you. My name is Gabby Fotopoulos, and this is my brave. Next up is Katrina.
My name is Katrina. I will be reading my poem titled Freedom in a Bird Tattoo to share my experience with anxiety and depression. I also want to share that anxiety can come in many forms, in the form of panic attacks that are so loud and all-consuming, you cannot help but notice your anxiety, and in more subtle ways, like being too nervous to go to the grocery store because you're terrified everyone will secretly judge you, but then you just never go. Or saying you too back to the waiter who just told you to enjoy your food. and replaying the event in your mind years after. It's important not to feed into the shame you may feel about the way you experience the world, even if it may be your first instinct to do so. Thank you, and I hope you enjoy. Some time ago, I pulled into a gas station during rush hour and instantly realized I'd made a huge mistake. Since I had pulled up on the wrong side of the pump, I had to reverse, while I was convinced the entire gas station had stopped to watch the show. After a few unsuccessful attempts at reaching the pump, I left, without gas, without dignity. And that night, I wanted to crawl out of my skin. I recalled every phone call I'd written an entire page of notes for, before picking up the phone and deciding, it's too late in the day anyway, and setting it back down. Every time, I nearly said no, but came up with 1,000 reasons why my voice did not matter enough. And every time I nearly said yes, but came up with 1,000 reasons why I did not matter enough. Every time my lungs screamed as my heart beat out of my chest, but no one knew I could not breathe because I did not want to make anyone uncomfortable. I sacrificed my body and my mind because I did not believe I deserved choice. These moments were small indicators of the war I fought with my mind and took out on my body. Anxiety clipped my wings and left me flightless. Every get over yourself, it's all in your head, you just need to be better, left another gash where my wings used to be, left me drowning in an ocean of my own creation. And most of these words came from myself. Soon, I convinced myself that I did not deserve a voice because I did not know how to use mine. Often, I believed I did not deserve a body because it had failed me so many times. Anxiety kept me stuck, while depression convinced me I was safe. It was a tug of war my body played, and I did not want to win. But I remember the first time I truly did something for myself, the first time I was ever really spontaneous. I decided I wanted a bird tattoo on my shoulder because I admire the way they find beauty in everything, how they do not fly just to escape, but to feel freedom. I chose a swallow, a sign of land after months on the endless sea. For the first time, I did not ask for permission. And for the first time, I rewarded my body by etching a mark of beauty onto my skin, not as punishment, but as an act of love. Sometimes I look at my shoulder, and I cannot remember who that woman was, especially when I am on my second page of notes before a phone call, you know, just in case I need to leave a voicemail. I have punished my body and my mind, let shame fill my heart for feeling too much, and letting depression slip in so I could feel nothing at all. But I've grown to like myself, and then slowly to love myself, finding poetry in the way I over-prepare, instead of finding shame there, allowing myself to make choices about more than just tattoos, and with those choices, finding the freedom I always wanted to create. Thank you. My name is Katrina Paschke, and this is my Brave. I'd like to introduce Bianca.
It was my freshman year of high school, Valentine's Day. I woke up and packed for school and practiced for my winter guard team. I walked out the door, and my dad drove me to school. He dropped me off, and I said goodbye. I walked in the gates seeing flowers, balloons, and Valentine's notes carried around the halls and went to band first period. Biology next. We had a fire drill in second period during a test. As I was changing classes from second to third, I sent a text to my mom saying, "Happy Valentine's Day. I love you, Mom," because she was asleep when I left for school that day. Then lunch was before the last period of the day. I sat next to my friend and met a new classmate, Kara. She seemed familiar, but this was the first time I formally met her. She had a big smile on her face, and my friend asked me if I wanted to walk with them around the courtyard. I passed on their offer. English came last, fourth period with Mrs. Lyons and our student teacher, Miss Rower. We were writing an essay. Time dwindled, and I debated whether or not I was going to go to the bathroom. I thought, well, there's only about 30 minutes of class. I'll wait till the end of the day. Suddenly, there was a loud bang, almost like someone hitting on metal so hard. One, and then another, and another, and before I knew it, my class ducked under my teacher's desk. We knew what to do in this situation. A code red lockdown drill had been talked about for weeks. The school was adamant on having the teachers show us a protocol for an active shooter drill. They played phone calls from the day of the Sandy Hook shooting to the teachers. Locate the safety zone and area out of sight from the door. Turn the lights off and silence all devices. If the fire alarm goes off, do not get up. If someone asks to be let in, do not let them in, no matter who they are. Wait for the safety code spoken by the principal to know that we were safe. That moment, right after we ducked under the desk, I was confused. My heart was pumping, and I didn't want to admit what was really happening. I was only halfway covered by the desk and sat in an awkward position. In my mind, I tried to assume that this wasn't real. They told us that there would be blanks in a code red drill. It's just blanks. You'll be fine. I turned off my phone. My family was not able to reach me. My classmate was sobbing, and my other peers helped to console her. Some were calling their family members, telling them that they loved them. I had no idea what to do in that situation. Do I act like everything is okay? Do I panic? Do I cry? Should I call my family and tell them I love them? Another student called 911 and repeatedly said, Stoneman Douglas is getting shot up. Stoneman Douglas is getting shot up. I panicked in the awkwardness of the situation. When I feel that way, I start laughing out of embarrassment. My friend Ashley and I were giving each other looks the entire time. We both seemed to think that what was happening wasn't what it was, right? The strange noises stopped for a bit, and we heard steps down the hall, then a jiggle on our doorknob. Our class lights were on, but our door was locked, luckily. I never processed what happened in that moment until many months later. The shooter tried to get into my classroom. Many minutes passed, and suddenly the fire alarm went off. Nobody moved, but that was not the reality for the rest of the building. The third floor of the freshman building had no idea what had been going on the past couple of moments. Almost all of the classrooms on the third floor started to evacuate in fear of a real fire. We had a fire drill that day, so now many thought a real fire must have been taking place. A hallway full of students and teachers caused chaos on the third floor when the shooter opened fire, killing many more. We heard more rounds of shots. They sounded distant, so we all relaxed as much as we could. Those 6 minutes were the longest moments of my life. Agonizing. Later, we heard the sounds of men in the hallway saying to open up. I heard the screams of girls next door, and in that moment, everything that just happened caught up to me. I was panicking, and Ashley looked at me and started sobbing. A couple minutes later, the police banged on our door, asking to let them in. My classmates screamed for my teacher to open the door, and she called out saying she would in a shaky tone. Before my teacher could open the door, they smashed the glass and came in, asking us to put our hands up. They ushered us out of the classroom. The hall was filled with smoke, covered in glass and gunpowder. The putrid smell of sulfur filled my senses. We walked single file down the hall. The police yelled out, "Look to the left," as we walked. I looked to the right and saw two bodies with no sign of life, a boy and a girl, face down. I got out of the building, bent over and heaved. Tears spilled violently down my face. My name is Bianca Romano, and I am a survivor of the shooting that occurred at Marjory Stoneman Douglas High School 4 years ago, Valentine's Day 2018 in Parkland, Florida. The mass shooting that occurred my freshman year injured 17 and killed 17 in a matter of 6 minutes using an AR-15 acquired legally by a 19-year-old former student. I later found out Kara Lugren, the girl I met at lunch that day, was one of the victims. The boy and the girl I saw in the hallway had been Luke Hoyer and Gina Montalto. Luke and I had been in school together since elementary. Gina was on my winter guard team with me. Alex Schachter, another student who lost his life that day, had been in the marching band with me, and I always think back to the Halloween I spent at his house with my family and friends. Days passed in a blur, candlelight vigils were attended, and political protests sparked. "We call BS," shouted in the streets of where I used to peacefully walk to school. News stations flooded the scene and pushed to talk to our traumatized community. I couldn't tear my eyes away from the news. The people I grew up with were killed. My thumbs scrolled through social media, seeing celebrity after celebrity talking about us. Videos and pictures of that day spread around, showing horrific images. They will never leave my mind. The first funerals I attended were for my young peers. I never thought I would see the caskets of people I saw innocently walking down my school hallways just days before. Before I even had the chance to catch my breath, my school was suddenly a part of an agenda. The Parkland survivors stood up and marched to the Capitol, pleading for change in legislation. Eventually, the media and political outrage quieted down a bit. The attention on my school dwindled, and now we were left dealing with new security measures and plastic see-through backpacks. We had hashtag MSC strong slapped on our chests, and the pressure of the entire world watching us go back to school. We felt like we were left to wipe our tears and lead a new political movement when days prior we had just witnessed our community crumble. No teacher was prepared to suddenly go back and teach high schoolers who just witnessed terrifying things, not even mentioning how traumatized the teachers were themselves. Every day, someone around me was set off by triggers. I felt guilty when I had a good day and saw other stuff suffering. I was enraged when teachers would come in with a big smile and acted like nothing had happened. And then I also got upset when teachers brought it up and brought me down when I felt like I was managing that particular day. It was a lose-lose. There were no right or wrong ways, and everyone's stage was unique and could turn in a second. My parents asked me if I wanted to change schools or even move out of Parkland, but on one hand, the idea of abandoning my community seemed cowardly, and the thought of being around people with no clue or sensitivity towards my experience sounded lonely and isolating. But then going to school every day and walking past that building, a violent crime scene, and getting triggered by loud noises or screams, going through fire drills and seeing news reporters parked outside my school every few weeks or months made it even harder to move on. The tremendous amount of survivor's guilt I was experiencing pushed me over the edge. I asked for help from my school and family and was luckily supplied with a therapist soon after. Since then, I have been in and out of therapy for 3.5 years. I have been treated by 3 different licensed therapists using various techniques, as well as treatment with prescribed medication from my psychiatrist. But some students were still in a sense of freeze, pushing away any thought of it and just focusing on their studies. Others in fight, angry and emotional, arguing with administration. The few that were in flight left the school. Some of them flourished outside of the environment of Douglas, and others felt misunderstood by their new schools. Rumors began about the new class of freshmen in my sophomore year. They were dropping books and smashing glasses on purpose in the hallways to frighten students. A boy in my world history class that year was then arrested by the FBI for threatening to bomb a military base. Other students in my class told me he would show them videos of shootings that took place across the world. The environment at Douglas was extremely tense due to obvious reasons. I witnessed my friends fall into a dark place. Many use alcohol, drugs, and other harmful coping mechanisms to push the pain away. I saw my teacher suddenly have mental breakdowns in front of my class and leave school early. During spring break, 2 students from Douglas lost their lives to suicide. Once again, our community was shaken. We were given a day off in a week to focus on mental health in school, but it felt ingenuine and mechanical. It wasn't what we needed. So many of us were still struggling and we were expected to move on. People across the world, along with teachers and staff at our school, told us to get over it. I knew I had to fight against the stigma around mental health. I'm a firm believer in mental health treatment, not only for survivors with PTSD, but for the average person. I hope with the destigmatization of mental health, we can help to consolidate a plan to end gun violence on a global scale, as mental health is one cause of gun violence. Not only must we help those after a traumatic experience, but also help to stop the next mass shooter by providing proper mental health treatment for all. The shooter from my school, Nick Cruz, was a broken kid. His mother struggled with drug addiction and his father was not present. He showed red flags as a young kid, killing small animals and having hostile behavior. The students at Douglas were afraid of him. He was on the FBI watch list and began acquiring guns. There were so many reasons as to why he should have been stopped before he committed this act of violence, but the system failed us and him frequently. After tragedies like the shooting at Stoneman Douglas, we tend to focus on the families of those killed, which indeed are important, but we forget the ones who survived. Us survivors are scarred in many ways, and the trauma is unlike any other pain. It's as much mental as it is physical. I still struggle day to day with triggers, even 4 years past that day. My parents grapple with secondary PTSD. Now that I am in college, Valentine's Day 2018 is far from the forefront of my mind, but I am still reminded of it. Two of my friends from Douglas live in my dorm building. Last semester, we had two false fire alarms in the middle of the night. My friend was thrown into reminders of that day when the fire alarm went off and panicked. A couple weeks ago, I found out about the suicide of someone I knew personally in middle school. It struck me. Sometimes it is not even the mental triggers that set us. On a Wednesday last semester, I was at Frisbee practice. My adrenaline spiked due to how much running I was doing, and suddenly my body began to panic. Despite knowing I was safe, my body was still having a physical reaction to the adrenaline. I had to step off the field and take 5 minutes to calm myself down. Our bodies behave differently due to our trauma. Our brains have been altered physically because of our trauma. Regardless of my bad days, I know I'm a strong and healed person. Witnessing my college peers fall down into their own bouts of depression and anxiety have shown that I have put in the work to heal myself. You sometimes cannot wrap your mind around the fact that people want to hurt others in this way, but yet my generation still has to deal with the effects of a broken system, preparing for when it happens to them. Now I'm taking the steps to ensure that people never forget what happened at Stoneman Douglas, Sandy Hook, Saugus, Santa Fe, Virginia Tech, Columbine, and what could be the next. I would like to end by stating the names of our fallen Eagles. May they rest in peace. The 17 that died that day. Alyssa Alhadef, 14. Scott Beagle, 35. Martin Duque Anguiano, 14. Nicholas Storet, 17. Aaron Feiss, 37. Jamie Gutenberg, 14. Chris Hickson, 49. Luke Hoyer, 15. Kara Lugren, 14. Gina Montalto, 14. Joaquin Oliver, 17, Elena Petty, 14, Meadow Pollock, 18, Helena Ramsey, 17, Alex Schachter, 14, Carmen Shentrup, 16, Peter Wang, 15, the three who lost their battle to grief, Sydney Aiello, 19, Calvin Desir, 16, Richard Wei Wu, 18. I would also like to mention the jacket here. That's the jacket I wore on the day of the shooting. By me taking it off, it represents how my youth and everything that I wanted high school to be was left that day. Once again, my name is Bianca Romano, and this is my brave. I would like to introduce the next storyteller and dancer, Emilee.
Hello, my name's Emilee Carreras. Today I'm going to be performing a dance piece for you all. I often find myself overthinking everything, overthinking things I can control, overthinking things I can't control, which leads to stress, which leads to anxiety, which leads to, can I do this, can I do that? It definitely stems from wanting to take advantage of every opportunity and learn new things, and then I turn around and I have like 12 things at one time, and it just all builds up. So I know that that's a thing that we all tend to do, and sometimes then we get left with, oh, well, I don't really have time, but I'll figure it out. At least that's what I do. So in this piece, it's all improvised. So that means it's freestyle. I'm only thinking about the next step that I'm gonna take, and I don't know what it is until I'm dancing it. So it's kind of ironic because this is so calming for me. It's kind of a meditation technique that I use, and I know some other dancers that instead of telling you our story with our words, we can express it in a different way with our bodies. So I urge anybody who wants to tell their story, I hope this inspires you to share it in any way that you need to. Dance, art, music, architecture, a math problem, a physics problem, like paint a picture, sing a song, anything you want to do that helps you feel better and is a way that you can share what's important to you, go for it.
breathing out. Embrace this as an opportunity to find a moment of peace in the midst of things needing your attention. There are no expectations, just the desire to be part of this present moment, exactly where you are, in this very moment, in the space you are in. All you have right now is your breath and your beautiful self. Sit in a comfortable position, either on the floor or in a chair. You can gently close your eyes or allow your focus to settle on a particular spot in front of you. And let that area around the spot to become just part of your soft focus. Notice the sensations of the things around you. Sounds in the room. The temperature of the air on your skin. The parts of your body that are touching the floor. Allow all these sensations to become part of this moment. It's okay to feel once you close your eyes, or allowing a soft focus for thoughts to rush in and fill this calm space. Understand that these thoughts are only gentle reminders of the world outside this moment of grace and calm you are giving as a gift to yourself. You are merely a witness to your thoughts, without commentary and without engagement. Enjoy a deep breath in through your nose and exhale through your mouth. Your body is already surrendering to this moment of peace, little by little. Allow any thoughts to merely be like images passing outside your window. You can see them, but they have no sound or feeling attached to them. These images move on when you cannot engage with them. Always bring your attention back to your breath when you feel those thoughts pull at you. I'm breathing in. I'm breathing out.
Right as soon as I set up, before I did it, I was supposed to say, hey, this is a meditation. If you want to do it, feel free. So I hope that you're able to enjoy and also take part in the meditation that was spoken by one of my professors here in the dance department. He is often trying to help us find our best version of ourselves. So I had asked him to be a part of this journey with me. My name is Emilee Carreras, and this is my brave. Next up, I would like to introduce Ashley to the stage.
I stood in the bathroom alone. I don't want to be alone, I just want to go. I'm blank, silent, incognito. I'm uncomfortable in my body. I imagine myself getting high, it would feel like I'm more away. I keep telling myself, you have to stay awake and pray every day. I can't do it anymore. I pour red ink on my skin. There's so much gossip. She's a lunatic. I know killing yourself is a sin, but what about my cries within? My mind is racing, voice left me, scared that the darkness will take me. Scars don't sweat. I'm broken. The cuts infect while I become a Trojan. I've lost all feeling on the skin I've cut. I fight myself from doing it in the gut. The scars don't heal what I've always tried to hide. Death doesn't stop the pain. It stops life. It is for these walls I rely, comfort and a place to cry inside. I eat my lunch, open wide. I swallow my tears and my pride. 6 years later, I'm asking myself, why? Y'all got to grow, but what about I? Big me doesn't comply because I've always wanted to die. Little me let my pain reign while no one was at my side. I stay in search of my truth. Therapy barely let my mind loose. Yearning for what once was my youth, the only way I could soothe was by the noose. That lady took advantage of me because I was soft. She was a teacher who didn't care about the cost. She'd break my heart in front of the entire class without getting caught. She thought she'd ought to assault a doe-eyed fawn. Though she'd say it was Satan from which I was spawned. Even now I live in fear that my captor is here. Sure, others think I'm safe, but to me, that remains unclear. The suffering that lady had bestowed upon me had been nuclear. I've held on to the idea that it was my fault. Maybe it was my skin that left her overwrought. Because of her spite, I had anxiety and never fought. Maybe it was my skin that made the lady miserable. Just because I'm broken doesn't mean I'm not beautiful. Huh? Just because I'm broken doesn't mean I'm not beautiful. I sure wanted to give her a mouth fistful. She said, it's ask, not X. Well, how about I ask you why? Why you gave me panic attacks? Why was it me that you'd see as a slack? Why did you hate my smile? Why did my skin have that impact? Maybe it's because, no. I'm sure it's because I'm black. And when I had that crack and the darkness came in, you were taken aback. And I was left the sidetrack. Yeah, black people get suicidal and sad. I hate the fact that I never uncovered my true strength until I left for college, independent. Met so many people that made me luminescent. The darkness was a soul suppressant. My trauma blocks love. I hold on to it just because I don't know who I am without bruises and some cuts. A night was so bad, I was left to the hospital's conduct. Boy, did I have to learn to adjust. I became a show dog when I saw how much it sucked. Bra removed, naked I stood. Diaper placed on, only to be fed sneak pills under a hood. Even after the fact, my therapist left me foregone. My therapist left me in a sea, unable to breathe. My therapist gave up on me. I wonder if the darkness is too deep. I once again try to put myself permanently to sleep. Out of the sky came an angel. It went in me to trust to mix and tangle. I roared and I grappled. I swung, and we battled. It was the darkness that came to dismantle. It was strong and mighty. I was withdrawn and flighty, smiling wryly. It smiled slyly. It watered a dead branch to an upright tree. This is me, Ashley, understanding, raving, and chanting that I don't want to be alone. I'm giving this life stopped by not a damn thing. I'm giving this life to resolve conflict. We're given this life because we're strong enough to live it. My name is Ashley Aces, and this is my brave.
Ladies and gentlemen, please just take a moment to give our cast members a round of applause once again.
just a few more remarks. I would like to invite to the stage to share her remarks, Frances Bradley Villiers of the REACH Grant Teaching and Learning Facilitators. This is what has made this show possible this evening. Frances, please join us.
Good evening. Good evening. I want to first just applaud all of the storytellers tonight. You all were moving and your vulnerability was transformational. So thank you for sharing. I hope you can hear me because I'm not good at fixing this mic. I would like to applaud all of the courageous storytellers that I just mentioned on the stage tonight. I'm Frances Bradley Villiers, the Learning and Development Facilitator for the Race, Equity, Arts, and Cultural History REACH Grant, which is a nationwide federal grant awarded to Art Schools Network and the USF Center for Paint. I extend greetings on behalf of Dr. Scott Allen, ASN Executive Director, and Dr. Denise Davis Cotton, the Director of the Center for Paint, Dr. Brett Kimker, Regional Vice Chancellor of Academic Affairs, and Dr. Karen Holbrook, Regional Chancellor on the Sarasota Manatee campus. We believe in promoting positive relationships focused on sharing of personal stories, insights, and strategies that influence and educate each other in positive ways to end the stigma of mental illness. We are delighted to build the partnerships through this production of This Is My Brave, the college edition, and help to foster collaborations that support a national network focused on implementing the authenticity, accuracy, and portrayal of mental health through storytelling, engagement, and education. Thank you for coming and enjoy your evening.
Our Brave cast tonight was able to shine a light on a topic that we just don't talk enough about. So I'd like to take a moment now to ask you, our audience, to be brave with us and to please acknowledge in some way, you can stand, you can wave, you can make a little noise, if you yourself have experienced mental illness or if someone you love has. Thank you. I've never said those remarks before and not seen that kind of response from the audience. It just goes to show you that we are all affected by mental illness. And simply being here today was an incredible start to building upon a movement of people who are willing to be more open and supportive to those who struggle. We hope that you'll think of This Is My Brave and that you'll use this experience that you've shared with us tonight as a way to start a conversation and keep it going. This is what it means to live brave. If you were moved by what you saw tonight, please consider making a contribution to This Is My Brave. To help us continue this vitally important work, you can also check us out on our website. There's lots of information about This Is My Brave in your playbill this evening. Thank you for your support. So we'd love to meet you in the lobby where we can gather and visit with the cast and our sponsors to celebrate the beauty that happened on this stage tonight. College students in the audience, if you're hearing more, if you're interested in hearing more stories from young people, you can check out our upcoming podcast. It's called Our Turn to Talk. This is My Brave is presenting the first season of this production, which is coming out in just a few days during the month of May. And this fall, we'll be presenting a documentary about the making of that podcast, also called Our Turn to Talk. And finally, college students, if you're interested and you're ready to take action right now, you can join us in our Brave community. You can go right outside those doors and visit with Society of Valued Minds and sign up to become a Brave ambassador. This is your opportunity to be an offstage storyteller and join This Is My Brave's newest grassroots movement. Now, I would like to invite the Dean of College of the College of Behavioral and Community Sciences, Dean Sarovich, to the stage to say just a few closing words. Dean Sarovich, thank you so much for your support of this show and of This Is My Brave.
So they told me I'm the closer. Julie Sarovich, Dean of the College of Behavior and Community Sciences, and so happy to share this evening with you. All I can say, number one, is wow. Can you believe what we just listened to and experienced tonight? This is fantastic. I've been in the field of mental health for almost 40 years as a student, as a clinician, as a researcher, as a teacher, as a supervisor. And I can say that I've seen lots of interventions over those years to destigmatize mental health. This tonight is different. This is very different. And it's different because these people sitting behind me owned their challenge. And that doesn't just make them brave, it makes them powerful. So I didn't know how I was going to feel at the end of this evening, but I can say I feel really good, and I hope you do too, because change is sitting right behind me. Please join me with one last round of applause for a very brave and proud, powerful cast. For a reception right outside the theater. Thank you.
I really got really exposed to a lot of just poetry that I found very insightful. I feel like I knew a lot of people in my life who have experienced self-harm, who have experienced eating disorders, and it was just so nice to see all the different arts come together in a way to display so many different types of mental health issues.
It was extremely touching, vulnerable. I'm a therapist, so I'm used to hearing stuff like this, but I appreciated the students coming out and just opening up, being vulnerable, being honest, not only with themselves, but trusting this process, trusting their process with mental health, I was touched. I cried a few different times, I laughed a few different times, but it was a serious, sensitive subject.
I loved it, honestly. It was just really eye-opening and inspiring, and just seeing everybody just share their stories and what they've been through was Honestly, it was just brave, you know, just seeing everybody open up, and just there was just power in the room, I'd say.
I think it's a really important thing to have mental health awareness, especially in today's age. A lot of us are struggling with it, and we can struggle with it together and overcome it together. So I'm really, really happy that I was able to be a part of this production, and I can't wait to see how it goes in the future as well. So I sit on the board of This Is My Brave, and I've seen this organization grow and thrive recently. Being able to focus stories on specific groups that may need a little bit more attention, providing safe spaces for different population stories from the Black community, stories from the APEDA community, and now stories from USF college students, I think is really gonna help change the culture around mental health on USF's campus. And I'm so excited to see this event. I'm excited for Dr. Kristen Kosilek. I'm excited that so many people came out to see this show. And I'm excited to see what's gonna come next. Continued conversations around mental health and truly seeing storytelling have an impact on saving lives.
First time here. It was a pleasure. We had a very interesting night. Touched our hearts.
Thank you.
Not just, yes, I have mental issues, but also here's how I deal with them, and kind of told the audience there's a way to deal with this, and dance is one form, but there's others too. It was just showing her way of dealing with mental illness.
Just as somebody who's gone through my own mental illness and struggle before and lost friends and family members to suicide and other struggles, it was just almost healing and kind of electric. I feel like just having that real, just 100% honesty, you know, nobody hiding behind kind of society stigmas and just kind of not being afraid to just open up and share what we all go through as humans.
Beautiful how they put all the different art colleges together. There were so many people who came together for this that was just, it wasn't just one here, person one here. It was really a community that they brought together.
Tonight was phenomenal. I'm a pharmacist, and one of the biggest challenges we have is convincing people the importance of getting help. And tonight's program was proof that you can heal from the inside out. Medications can help, therapy can help, but truly being able to just release and express yourself is therapeutic. And so they inspired me tonight, sharing their stories, and I hope that others will be inspired and recognize that it's okay. It's okay, but I appreciate them being brave and giving the rest of us courage.
This is a form of an outlet. Just like they mentioned, dance, art, music, just conversation. This is another form of an outlet, and it was absolutely touching. A performance like this, storytelling with their being brave with their mental health, it is absolutely needed in society today, just to bring more awareness. So letting everyone know that it's okay to be open and honest and truthful with not only themselves but with others, because with that, being truthful, being honest, allows other people to open up. And it needs to be just a conversation, nothing heavy, just a conversation, just to let people know that support is out there and there's people dealing with it. You're not alone.
Honestly, it was powerful. I think Dean Sarek said it right. It was not just brave, but it was powerful. And the truth was cutting. It was illuminating. It was just breathtakingly authentic and transformative. So thank you. And it's just a wonderful organization, wonderful team. Thank you for what you do, Queen. Love you all. Peace out.